Hi class, it's Bill Berry with an intro to chapter 2 in the Python book on input, processing, and output. In this chapter, we're going to talk about a lot of stuff that gets us started with Python, and in this video, we're going to cover a couple of specific concepts just to give you a quick introduction, get you off to a good start, hopefully. We're going to talk a little bit about the program development cycle and the design aids that you may want to use when you're working on design. We're going to look at input, processing, and output and talk about some of the commands that you'll need to know there. We're going to talk about how to set aside some computer memory so that you can store stuff and use that stuff in that's called variables. We'll also talk briefly about calculations and the different kinds of operators you can use, and then what the implications are, including precedence and parentheses and stuff like that. And last but not least, we'll cover the powerful formatting utility that's available in Python and give you some examples and reference for how that works. So hopefully good stuff for you. First of all, your book talks a little bit about the programming development lifecycle. And you can see that the general flow here is that you want to analyze the problem and really understand it fully. Then you want to design your approach to the problem. It's more and more important as your programs get bigger that you spend some time on the design. You also want to then code up the problem, test and debug until you have gotten it as perfect as it can be. No such thing as a completely perfect program, but get it as close as you think is appropriate for the application, and then document your work in some sort of fashion. Again, bigger, fancier projects may need more documentation, but certainly there's a little work to do there. So that's the general flow of the thing. Now, during this design phase, as you're figuring out what your solution to the problem is going to be, you're starting to kind of think more in terms of computing and how you're going to translate things into language. But if you jump into that before you figure out the logic, that's a little premature. So there are two tools that are often used in figuring out how you're going to logically break these things down and take the step-by-step approach. One of them is called pseudocode. That's what you see on the left here. Pseudocode is that you write down basically English-like statements. They don't look like code exactly. They look like steps. So for instance, get wage from user, get hours worked from user, calculate the pay amount by taking wage times hours, and then display the pay amount. So you can see that any human could follow that. It's not Python, it's not, you know, it's just a series of steps. So that's a really good way to do things. There's another option here, and that is flowcharting. You see that on the right. In a flowchart, different kinds of operations have a different shape. So for instance, there's a start and end symbol that looks like a capsule, sort of. And then you'll see there's an input that's in a parallelogram. And then there's a calculation that's in a rectangle. And you see the flow of this thing. Now, these things get interesting when there are decisions, as we come to that later. Flowcharts are used in a lot of places, not always just in computing, but when you're trying to figure out processes in general. So it's nice to know a little bit about flowcharting and what the symbols are, because you will see this in other options, again, just in, you know, sort of normal understanding normal processes and workflows. So either of these will be good options. One of the things I want to show you that I like about pseudocode is that if you take that pseudocode, you can write this in Word or Notepad or whatever you want to do, or you can actually write it in the IDLE. So let's look at hello. This is just a sample, you know, sample file, doesn't matter. I'm just going to paste all my pseudocode there, and then I'm going to turn all of these into comments by just putting a pound sign in front of it. Now, the thing that I like about this is that now I can go and separate these things out and start writing the code under each line that does the thing in question. So get wage from user, I can say, you know, wage equals input, right? Enter wage. Right, and so forth. And of course I want to make that an integer, so I'm gonna whatever. So you can use pseudocode and then turn it into comments and then write code under each comment that expresses that in a little block of code. Now this is too simple. I wouldn't write a comment for every single line of code, but you get the idea. As your programs get more complicated, this can actually be a really nice thing. And then you don't feel like you've wasted anything. In fact, you can write the pseudocode in here. And then some programming languages will let you take that and actually sort of make documentation out of those comments. I don't know how to do that in Python. Anyway, that's an idea of how maybe you could use pseudocode and put it to work directly. Now, we're going to be doing a lot of input, processing, and output early, especially in this quarter. And so there are some built-in functions, built-in words that Python understands that help you with that. Getting input from the user, you're going to use input, and displaying things on the screen, you're going to use the word print. Both of these things will have all of the information that you're sending to that command in parentheses after. The other thing that you need to know, and we'll talk more about data types as we go here, but if you're going to print out specific messages or strings, text to the user, or give them prompts and things like that, you need to put that text in apostrophes. That's the standard, or you can actually use quotes here as well. Either one of those things, but you can't just leave them plain. So if you want to print out the text hello to the user, you can't do this first example where it says hello with no quotes around it. Because what Python's going to say is, I've never heard of this hello thing. What do you mean by that? And so you're going to get an error saying, I don't know what you mean by hello. But if you put it in apostrophes, it goes, oh, okay, this is some text that you want to use literally as you see it here. So don't forget the apostrophes around your literal text. And then the last piece is, we're going to talk more about variables in a minute, but when you get input, you actually need to store the result somewhere, because if you just gather the input from the user and then discard it, that's not very useful. So you want to use the input statement on the right, and then an equal sign to its left, and on the far left, you're going to put the name of the place where you want to store that, which is a variable. Again, talk about that more in a minute. So something like username equals input, enter your name. That's the general form to input and output, and we're going to get into more details right now, in fact. So if you want to hold some stuff in memory, if you want to put some data aside and you want to be able to use that, you want to assign values to it, you want to use that data, you need the concept of variables. Now, every variable has a name because that's how you refer to it. You don't want to refer to an internal memory location. That would be kind of difficult. So you need to be able to name your variables. And so let's talk about the naming convention here. First of all, variable names need to start with a letter. They always need to start with a letter. They can then use numbers, underscores, but they cannot have spaces in them. And these rules are fairly typical of most languages. The underscore may be slightly different, but pretty much this is true of other programming languages as well. So on the first line here in red, you see a bunch of bad usernames. You can't say user space age because space is not allowed. You can't say first payment because you have to start with a letter. And you can't use miles dash per gallon because dashes or hyphens are not allowed in variable names. But on the second line, you see those rewritten as valid variable names. It is fairly typical, even though that you can use underscores, it's fairly typical for you to start with a lowercase letter, and then every subsequent word that's smushed together in the variable name, you uppercase that word, that first letter. So that one on the right, miles per gallon, that would be the typical way to do it, mostly because underscores are just harder to type, and you know, it's pretty easy to read that anyway. Now, when you want to assign a value to a variable, the way that you do it is you put the variable names and then the name, and then you put an equal sign, and then you put either a specific number or text or whatever you want to assign to that, which is also known as an expression because it can be some math in there as well. Now, please don't confuse this equal sign with its, you know, normal use that you think about it being equality. You are not saying these are equal. You are saying, let the thing on the left, the variable on the left, have this following value. In fact, the way that you can read it is, let this variable take the value of whatever is there. So, for instance, let user age take the value 29. Let user age take the value dog age divided by 7. Right? So these are valid things. Now, if you get this right, the next example here looks strange maybe to your eye because it looks like something that can't be true in terms of equality, and it's not. Again, an equal sign does not mean equality, it means gets the value of. So you're saying, let user age get the value of user age plus 1. So what have we done in essence? We've added 1. They had a birthday, so we added 1 to what was in user age and put it back in user age. Now, you can have different types of data in variables. You can use numbers of various types. You can have integers, and you can have floating point numbers, which means you can have things after the decimal. If you're using numbers in these expressions, you don't have to do anything special, just use the numbers. But if you're using text, as mentioned before, you need to put apostrophes around it so that it knows it's text and doesn't think it's a variable name. So there's some examples on this page. Age equals 29, tax rate equals 0.0925, and employee name equals Dana. Right, so these are ways that you can set aside memory and then use them and in variables, and that's a powerful way to start on your programming. Now, we have quite a few other things to talk about here, and I think I'm going to stop the video now, and then we'll pick it up with a second video so it doesn't get too terribly long. So keep watching, and we'll see you soon.